start this foundation of Western Kazakhstan. As you know, Western Kazakhstan is president of the EU-Parliamentary Section, the Scientific Committee, and consequently the right person to take over the very demanding job to condense 2 years of research in biology into 20 minutes. Good luck.
and the way the result was expressed, for instance, in an experiment where we had 10 bees in one cage, we saw that the bees were suffering from the one that has taken only few amount and one that has taken much. And then there was calculated a ratio between the second and the ninth from various cages. So you see the results can vary very much. And this ratio could be from 1.3 to 93 in an experiment with 133 cages. So what does this mean? In an extreme situation, you have one bee that has taken almost nothing from this solution, and another bee that has taken the 204 amount. Of course, this influences the results. But so far, the results are only calculated on the basis of 10 bees, 5 have died, so we have a certain toxicity. I think that's a very important work, and we had to follow several new experiments on this topic. Just to show you that the relation is rather regular if you look at different cages. Something that's a little bit more funny. Everyone knows that there are huge differences in the success rate of burrower treatment. And one of the things that mathematically we are proving very well is that mite counting helps. So if you look at which beekeepers are really counting the number of mice in their colony, and which beekeepers have the lowest losses during winter, there was a high correlation because you looked carefully were the best ones that had the lowest losses during the following winter. That means, of course, counting alone does not help, but counting and then acting, that really helps. But we always have to consider also mathematical ways of thinking, so mite counting helps. When we looked at these beekeepers that were mite counting, and you see this in the picture, we also got an interesting overview about how beekeepers are treating with different agents, the formic acid and the oxalic acid, the most important ones. And you see that the beekeepers, in this case in Austria, that the beekeepers are doing it at the right moment, because formic acid is also working inside the blood cells, and oxalic acid is only working outside the blood cells, so you can use these if you don't have any closed group anymore. The second chapter I'm focusing on is immunity and social immunity, and this is a board paper of Mara's Peter. And you can very well see that you have very many different levels of immunity, starting in the inner circle with a single bee with its own singular immune system, then going to the next circle where we have a pairwise defense, might be killing, might be blooming, or colony defenses such as task differentiation, so removing sick brood, for instance, or minimizing the entry of infectious agents, or even the use of resins and other environmental products in colony shielding. There's a recent paper by a good set of all, it's a review paper that shows this more in detail, and it's discriminating the individual defense mechanisms and the colony defense mechanisms. And for instance, here for varroa on this side shown, we have the individual level, so for instance, substances produced that are slowing down the development of varroa, or bees removing sick and disease, in this case, varroa loading bees, or pruning behavior if one bee is removing varroa from the other. Or also the level of colony defense, swarming is something that helps bees to get rid of various dangerous diseases and parasites. Another level of immunity and social immunity could be shown by Hernandez Lopez. He showed that bees have a profile on their surface fields. So if you see this green in the middle and the revenue workers around, the revenue workers are permanently in contact with the green, and of course, vice versa, the green is permanently receiving information by the green. If the revenue workers now are infected or infested with an agent, in this case, it's particles from viruses, so the bees are not really diseased. They are not dying from this disease, but they show reactions against bacteria. And then the bees were either caged together in here, in this compartment, or in this compartment. And in all the experiments where the bees had contact with the queen, you could see that first workers injected just with saline solution had contact with the queen, or workers injected with LPS, other substances from the bacteria, or workers injected with LPS that had no contact to the green. This was the experimental setup. And if you please compare this case over the first column and the last column, you see in this case always a significant difference in the production of substances that are responsible for the immune defense of the green. What does this mean? In the moment, has contact with a nurse bee who is caring for her, and this nurse bee has on her surface substances that indicate that there is an infection. In this moment, the queen herself starts to increase her immune defense against the bacterium. She did not sense the bacterium because there was no bacterium, but the reaction of the workers is sensed. And that's a completely new aspect of social immunity. So if I compare, I summarize this experiment, wounding and injection produce an immune response in the workers. This produces the modulation of the chemical communication of the worker queen. Accordingly, queens detect unhealthy workers, and they trigger an upregulation of genes in the humor response in queens. Finally, mediated by alteration of the CH substances on the surface of the bee profile of the worker. This method of injecting particles of bacteria is also used by other scientists, and it is shown that in the workers, there's a reduction of activity, there's an appetite reduction, so they really behave like sick other animals, and there's a reduction of animal movement, that means a reduced contact with other bees. So bees can really feel sick. In another experiment, also the effect of very low viral infections could be shown. In this case, it was the deformed virus, and with very small doses loaded bees showed an increased mortality of the whole colony, although it was a very low dose. The pre-nature foraging, so the whole colony behaves differently, a reduced forager period, so it means they are dying earlier. There are many data on the market about sub-lethal pesticide influence on adult bees, but the knowledge about larvae is very much reduced. Though this gap was filled by another paper, 2017, by office. They tested imidacloprid and they showed that they have synergistic effects in larvae now. This bacteria, in this case, it was American foul root. It causes a decrease, a drastic reduction of the total and differential hemocyte counts in other cells that are responsible for immune reactions to larvae. And another author, Hunt, showed that three neonicotinoids had a heavy impact in hemocyte density, in this case of the head of bees, of the encapsulation response, or the reaction against bacteria, for instance, is tackle them and to kill them in this way. And the antimicrobial activity is also higher. With this, I'm coming to the last chapter, my hobby, the nutrition of the honeybee, and it's at the same moment the bridge to the next speaker, a group around Pascale in 2016 investigated the influence of different pollen on the development of colonies. Of course, we don't need the vines, that's not the purpose of this slide. You should just see that in different periods, these were released in France, in different periods, the amount of different pollen is different. So each color needs a different kind of pollen. This is May, July, and fall. These are collecting different pollen, of course, in the nature. And these different pollen have different values for the bees. So, for instance, if you look at these curves, you see here the age of the bees and here the survival rate. But these are not the bees in July, May, September, August, May, and June. These days are the days when the pollen was collected. And here you see of a group of bees tested at one certain moment, all of these of different kinds of pollen had a good result for the life expectancy of the bees. And this one, the pollen was collected in late July, has a significantly worse quality and a higher death rate of the honeybees. So not all pollen mixtures collected by the bees are equally good. And the next slide shows that in this case, the pollen amount is reduced. A means that there is no pollen in this experiment, and the bees are going to die very early, and 100% means they have more pollen than they ever needed. And you see a clear dependency of the amount of pollen that was fed to the bees. So that's rather logical. If you need protein, if you do not get protein, you will suffer, and quality will be suffering. But what was not so clear was this result, that if you are feeding collected pollen, as it is in the nature, as it is here, you can have differences over the year, and this is seen clearly in this laboratory experiment. Thus, we have again collected, we means the world of science, related to nutrition, agrochemicals, and diseases. The last chapter was nutrition and health, and at the end of my talk, I want to give over the stage to our invited speaker, Professor Geraldine Wright. She is professor at the moment at the University of Newcastle, at the Institute for Neuroscience. You can see she was in Newcastle, Ohio State University, and Oxford University, and from